you, Rosie. Well, as Adam said after his brilliant but chilling talk, I'm on last to cheer you up. Unfortunately, I'm going to tell you a tale of hubris, madness, and death. It might distract you. I don't know if it will cheer you up. Now, the story that I'm going to tell is operatic in scope, and I'll try and condense it into 12 minutes. And it involves some of the most famous people of their time. Yet outside of Mexico, where most of the action happened, I don't think many people know about it. I do think, though, perhaps you might know how it ends, because there's a very famous painting, which I will get up on as a slide in front of us now. This is the execution of Maximilian by the French artist Edouard Manet. And the man in the center is indeed Ferdinand Maximilian, Habsburg Archduke, who was caught up in these monumental events in the 1860s. And so today I'm going to try and answer a question that he himself might well have been wondering in this moment captured on canvas. What on earth is a man born in Vienna, an Austrian Archduke, doing facing a firing squad in Mexico? And the story actually has quite a lot of parallels with recent events and foreign interventions, because that's what brought him there. It's an example of regime change on an epic scale in Mexico. And so why on earth Mexico? Well, there were some in Mexico who called for him to rule over them as a monarch. They wanted to replace a republic with a monarchy. And why did they want that? Well, the story of Mexico in the 19th century is not a happy one. It's what today we might anachronistically call a failed state. And there's two key reasons for this. The first one is its proximity to the United States of America. As a later Mexican president famously said, poor Mexico, so far from God, so close to the United States of America. And that quote would be no more opposite than in 1846, when the United States of America starts an illegal war, invades Mexico, and sends a small expeditionary force that marches its way inland, occupying Mexico City, and the stars and stripes unfurled across the magnificent central plaza and with the Catholic cathedral looming on one side. Now, those US troops only leave at an extortionately high price. Mexico is forced to sign away nearly half of its national territory. This is places like California today, used to be part of Mexico. That's the price to get US troops out. And it's a national trauma and humiliation, this disastrous defeat to the United States. Which Mexico doesn't really recover from. And unfortunately, the second reason is in the 1850s, rather than Mexican politicians rallying behind to try and unify the nation and build it up again, there's a civil war that breaks out between liberals and conservatives. Liberals led by Benito Juarez, and they are arguing for secularization, modernization, breaking the power of the Catholic Church. Another faction, the Conservative Party, arguing for the opposite. They believe the only thing binding Mexico together is the Catholic Church. Now, Benito Juarez wins in 1861. He enters the capital in triumph, holds elections, and becomes the constitutional president. But conservatives never accept the result. In fact, they flee to Paris, where they plot the overthrow of Benito Juarez. And what they want to do is establish a monarchy, because what I didn't tell you about Mexico is it actually becomes independent, unlike most other Latin American countries, as a monarchy. And to make Mexico great again, to coin a phrase, they think they need to return to that original independence plan. Now, of course, they're not powerful enough to do it themselves. Otherwise, they would have done. They've been defeated in civil war. But in Paris, they have the ear of one of the most powerful men in the world at the time. And here he is, Napoleon III. Magnificent moustache, I always think, but don't let that beguile you. He is a devious man who's launched his own attack on democracy in France in 1851. So he was, in fact, the first ever elected president of France, but the constitution of the republic he was president of prevented him from standing for a second election. And if you know your Bonaparte's history, he's the nephew, by the way, of the more famous one, then the obvious solution to these kind of constitutional problems is a coup d'etat. He overthrows the Second Republic, which is the regime he himself is president of, and founds an empire in France. So having overturned the republic and turned it into a monarchy, in his own country, doing so in another doesn't seem quite so outlandish. And what the Mexican conservatives offer him is empire on the cheap, so that they will give France all of the benefits of colonialism in the 19th century, but at a fraction of the cost, because the French army is going to play a relatively small role. Or so Napoleon III hopes. Now, for any monarchy, you need a monarch, and that's where we have Maximilian, and indeed his wife, Princess Charlotte, who should be on your screens now. So Maximilian, he's the younger brother of Franz Joseph, Emperor of Austria. Maximilian is convinced of his destiny to rule, but that's classic trope in history. He's the second son. And Franz Joseph doesn't really like his brother. Maximilian is outgoing, he's gregarious, he's liberal, he's popular. Franz Joseph, very rigid, conservative, autocratic. So he keeps Maximilian at a distance. Now, another person who's convinced of Maximilian's destiny to rule is his wife, Princess Charlotte, better known to Mexican history as Carlotta. Precociously talented and determined to succeed. She's always encouraging Maximilian onto greater things. And in fact, Maximilian builds his fairy tale castle overlooking the Adriatic, beautiful, you know, visited today, Miramar. But Carlotta, once she's installed there, she writes that she sees her life just staring out to sea until old age. So when the offer of a crown in Mexico comes in 1861, that allure of power and glory across the Atlantic is preferable to perpetual Europe, at least it is. Now, there are several problems with this plan, not least that the throne is imaginary. So this is the regime change and European imperialism, egregious example of it. The French army invades Mexico, and despite the promises of exiles in Paris, the Mexican nation rallies behind the constitutional president of Juarez. Napoleon III only sends 6,000 troops, which gives you an indication of how easy he thinks it's going to be. And as these troops march on their way up to Mexico City, they stop before the walls of the second city of Mexico, Puebla. And the French army deploys in front of the city, the commanding officer incredibly confident that they're going to be victorious, but wave after wave of French infantrymen cut down by the heroic resistance of Benito Juarez. This goes down in Mexican history as Cinco de Mayo. So next time you're celebrating that, it's not about Mexican independence, it's about defeating the French. Napoleon III, undeterred, sends reinforcements and eventually does take the capital. But it's not until 1864, so this is nearly 3 years after Maximilian and Carlotta accept the invitation, that they arrive in their new kingdom. And as they make this transatlantic voyage, they sail into the port of Veracruz and they look at their kingdom for the first time. And the docks are deserted. There's no one there to greet them. We'd expect pomp and ceremony and cheering crowds to receive the new monarchs. Napoleon III has told them they will be welcomed as heroes. This isn't the case. Now, there is some support for them in Mexico. They're not entirely bereft of sympathizers, but it's certainly not what Napoleon III had told them. And when they get to Mexico City, there's a much bigger reception and it's well orchestrated. But there are three huge problems that Maximilian and Carlotta need to solve. The first is that Benito Juarez has not been defeated. He's merely retreated northwards. The second is the United States of America is hostile to a monarchy on its borders, as you might expect. And the third is finances. Napoleon III has launched what we might call a leverage buyout. He's put the entire cost of this intervention onto the Mexican treasury, and Maximilian must meet those payments or Napoleon III can withdraw his troops. Now, to cut a long story short, Maximilian is not the man best equipped for the job. It would take a leader of extraordinary ability to overcome those problems. Maximilian is not without some talent. He's a good linguist, he's intelligent, he's charismatic in person, but he also has traits that don't lend themselves to this kind of crisis. He prevaricates, procrastinates, and is a huge interest of his is in science and butterflies. He often gets distracted by butterflies, he goes butterfly hunting, rather than engaging in key government business. So you can see this is not necessarily the leadership skills you want at the crisis. Under enormous pressure from the United States of America and the continued resistance of Benito Juarez, Napoleon III does that moment, which probably stood out to me when reading through the sources and language that the French emperor uses. He announces to the French people that mission accomplished. French troops are what they came to. Maximilian's empire is secure. French troops will be withdrawing in a phased withdrawal. Now, of course, that's just public consumption. And when Maximilian finds out that French troops are going to be withdrawing, he decides to abdicate. He thinks the game is up. He can't continue without French assistance. Carlotta is furious. She refuses to accept defeat. She tells him that it's cowardice. It will be besmirching his name, or dishonorable. So she will go back to Paris and convince Napoleon III to change his mind, which she does, but she fails. Napoleon III doesn't change his mind. Now, she's got one more trick up her sleeve, and that's to appeal to the Pope. So she travels to the Vatican. The idea is to get the Pope to endorse Maximilian's regime and that will rally Catholic Mexico behind the empire. But instead of discussing church-state relations, she has an incredibly dramatic meeting with Pope Pius IX. She breaks down in tears, uncontrollable sobs, in the corridors of the Vatican in front of the Pope, accusing Napoleon III of trying to poison her, claiming that her entire entourage is in the pay of the French Emperor, who is out to murder her. Now, of course, this is delusion, paranoia. She's had a complete breakdown from which she never recovers and never goes back to Mexico, in fact. So meanwhile, back in Mexico, and I'll wrap this up quickly, Maximilian, when he hears that his wife has had this breakdown, and he hears that Napoleon III is definitely withdrawing, his entire world shatters. They were very close, and she had helped him in ruling his empire. So he decides to abdicate again. But again, he's talked out of it. And this is one of the key moments where he goes butterfly hunting. He gets his ministers to deliberate on whether he should stay. Rather than listen to that, he goes butterfly hunting. In the end, they convince him to stay because they tell him it would be dishonorable for a Habsburg to leave his post. Now, they have a plan. And by the way, by this point, Maximilian's empire is shrinking because Benito Juarez forces are resurgent. There's no longer French support. And of course, those imperialistas, people fighting for Maximilian, are not really that much of a leadership's tactic to whether he's going to stay or go. So in fact, the Juaristas are sort of taunting the imperialistas and saying, well, the emperor's abdicated, you're fighting for a lost cause, even though Maximilian eventually decides to stay. It's huge damage. Now, the plan is that Maximilian will lead an army to a town not far from Mexico City. And here they will converge on the Juarista forces and win as the symbolic battle that will revive the fortunes of the empire. And it sounds like a desperate plan, and it is. Maximilian is going to lead the army. He's never led an army before. He's never even served in an army. And very soon in the small town, Querétaro, they're under siege for 2 months. Maximilian is heroic in his own mind. I think he saw it as glorious. But one of his most loyal officers, after 2 months, crosses over into enemy lines, betrays him, and leads the Juarista forces into the walls. And this is the citadel. It was formerly a convent citadel in which Maximilian put his headquarters, and you could see the damage from artillery fire and fighting. He's very quickly court-martialed and sentenced to death, which brings us back to the man in painting. Now, it's historically inaccurate. He wasn't in the center. He wasn't wearing a sombrero. But I think it does have a wider truth in it, some of which Maximilian would have enjoyed. He's meeting his death with a calm stoicism and honor, and he was obsessed by honor. But perhaps better for him is the fact that the man preparing the coup de grace just off to the right has the conspicuous features of Napoleon III. And so the implication from Manet is clear. It was the foreign intervention and the regime change that is responsible for having blood on its hands. I'll leave it there because I think I'm running out of time.